Hello watch enthusiasts and welcome to Watch Chronicler. Military watches bring a certain untold mystique to the average watch collector. Perhaps it's the idea of a watch being made for nothing more than the brutality it'll be exposed to, or perhaps it's the stories, many of which will forever remain untold, lived by watches taken into combat. It may even be the distance between a state-commissioned military watch and the luxury watches we see today. Whatever the reason may be, the fame of military watches has only grown from the Rolex Mill Subs, now worth well over £100,000, Omega Military Seamaster 300s following very closely, and Breguet Type 20s remaining very popular choices at auction. Nationally speaking, Britain has had a very fair share of the world's great military watches, with the aforementioned two dive watches, the Omega and IWC pilot's watches used during and just after the Second World War, and then the various quartz field watches used in the late 20th century, which today are some of the best buys out there as far as used, tough tool watches go. In fact, 12 of the most famous watches used by Britain were a key product of the Second World War, at a time when Britain couldn't rely on supply of British watches for its infantry. As a result, a set of specifications were laid out for simple, general-purpose watches for the average soldier. An abridged list would include a case of between 35 and 38 millimeters in either stainless steel or chromed metal, a shock and waterproof case, a shatterproof crystal, in period a plastic crystal, a black dial with a railway-style minute track, as well as luminous hands and hour markers, and a chronometer-grade movement between 11.75 and 13 lines, that's to say 26.5 millimeters, 29.3 millimeters in diameter. As a consequence of the period of production, all of these movements were manually wound due to the scarcity, in relation to the rest of the industry, of automatic winding movements. Ultimately, 12 brands were able to provide such watches, which fundamentally all looked rather similar due to the specifications and the nature of movements at the time. The following brands provided offerings: Jaeger-LeCoultre JLC, IWC, Omega, Longines, Eterna, Lemania, Buren, Record, Vertex, notable for being the only British example, Timor, Seimer and Grana, the rarest and most valuable of the lot. Amusingly, these Dirty Dozen watches, named after the 1967 war film, most likely never served in the war as their official delivery date took place at the very end of 1945, yet they were still crucial for providing the blueprint for military field watches essentially to the present day. These watches also provided the blueprint for the watch I'd like to review today, the Vaer A12 Dirty Dozen, a watch presented as a Dirty Dozen-style field watch offering value to the discerning buyer of today. When I first heard about this watch, I was on a Zoom call to the charming co-founders of Vaer, Ryan Torres and Reagan Cook. They spoke passionately about how their founding of Vaer was to provide affordable, everyday wristwatches with a balance of durability and elegance, especially for a price which was more reasonable than the watches they had in the past aspired to own. To this end, Vaer has a collection of varied watches spanning the market from everyday watches to more specialised dive watches, but most importantly, appealing in my mind to a broad, less technical audience than the hardcore watch enthusiast. As such, this presents a strange duality to the A12. The balance between providing a credible successor to the military watches of the 1940s for enthusiasts and delivering a rugged, affordable, modern field watch. As you'll see, this duality arguably compromises both aims, yet leaves us with an important question. Has Vaer made an intriguing watch for both markets, or for neither? First, let's begin with the context and perspective. This watch costs $899, just over £800 after import duty to the UK, which means that it sits at the very top of the Vaer collection, and for better or for worse, competes with the very top of Tissot products and the very bottom of those produced by Longines, if we're to use the Swatch Group as a gauge. Something to understand about the A12 is that Vaer have, as far as I can see, followed the spirit and for the most part the letter of the original Dirty Dozen specifications to a T. The case is stainless steel in a 36mm size, but with a particularly square appearance on account of being only 43mm long from lug to lug, with a surprisingly wide 20mm lug width. Amusingly, even the WWW caseback markings of the original watches remain present, indicating watch, wristlet, waterproof. Of course, the original watches all had their idiosyncrasies, so it makes sense for Vaer to choose their own design, in this case a fully brushed case, with the exception of bevels running down the lugs, an understandably more complex appearance than the 1940s counterparts. Additionally, one's indulged with an exhibition caseback, clearly a frivolity unbefitting a military watch in period, but a very nice addition to the A12, but more on that later, because through the window is visible something very interesting. Speaking of the case, this is where you can begin to see my quandary about the A12. You see, whilst Vaer should absolutely be praised for delivering a 100m water-resistant watch with a very modest 10.2mm thickness to the top of a domed crystal, The broad-lugged stance does show how trying to appeal to a modern user and a vintage collector's market can compromise both. The wide lug width and narrow lugs result in a watch which looks somewhat disproportionate, but which lives up to the brand's desire to have interchangeable 20mm straps across the range. Whether that's a valid trade-off will be up to each individual buyer. Where finishing is concerned, the A12 has a similar duality. For the most part, this is a very acceptably finished watch, with those polished bevels giving extremely attractive contrast to an otherwise understated brushed finish. Likewise, the circular graining on the bezel, itself carefully sunken into the lug structure and beveled for variety, is consistent and appealing. However, you also get the sense that this watch would have been better off costing more for greater consistency. What do I mean? Well, if you examine the bevels on the lugs, they're slightly different lengths. The brushing on the case sides is good, but just isn't as good as an equivalent Tissot or Longines at this particular price. Don't get me wrong, the finishing isn't bad, but it just isn't a match for the amount of obvious care and expense going into other areas. In any case, it isn't the case itself which will bring an average buyer close to the feats of derring do which the original watch is no doubt experienced, but the dial. For this part of the watch, Vaer have followed a wise line of not replicating any specific Dirty Dozen watch, but instead venturing a guess as to what they might have made given the specifications in period. As such, you see all the iconic details integral to the DNA of these watches, the railway-style minute track punctuated with luminous markers, the clear, simple Arabic numerals, and the bold small seconds at 6 o'clock. In line with this watch's dual aim, the design is undoubtedly on the more conservative end of the scale for the sake of legibility, and in this regard, the dial is a success. A curious touch is that the hands, themselves painted white for the sake of high contrast, are curved upwards in their centre in order to move away from the dial. Whilst this may sound odd, it actually helps the watch's legibility at extreme angles, particularly when trying to see where the very tip of the minute hand sits between markers. There are, however, a few provisos which suggest to me that Vaer conceived the A12 with more of a popular crowd in mind than for either the serious vintage enthusiast or for the lover of tough tool watches. The dial details themselves are very well printed onto a matte black base, which, whilst perhaps a tad finely grained, has a very clean, refined look. In truth, the only visible blemishes are seen on the hands, where, in places, the paint seems a touch inconsistent. Still, this is acceptable for the price. What bothers me, though, is that there are some minor oversights across this area of the watch. Take, for example, the Swiss-made designation at the bottom of the dial. Now, I realise that Vaer, quite rightly, want to make a point of this, as their collection is split between Swiss and more affordable non-Swiss models. But even so, they've placed this text right across the minutes track, thus impeding legibility between 27 and 33. Whilst this isn't going to bother everyone, this wasn't the case on the original watches, and for rather good reason. Even so, there remains an awful lot to like about the A12. Perhaps the best example of this is the movement, an absolutely fantastic piece for the price, and frankly a surprising one too. This watch uses the Pissot, or ETA nowadays, 7001, a movement available since the 1970s, and which has become a real favourite amongst industry standard, manually wound movements, with a thin profile and small seconds at the ever-elegant 6 o'clock position. Until 2005, in fact, this was NOMOS' main manual calibre, with some of their recent movements based upon this very movement, and even Blancpain has used it in high horology applications, with heavy revisions. Of course, it's still a somewhat old-school movement with a 3Hz beat rate, a 42-hour power reserve, and no hacking, but what it loses in complexity, it gains in pure watchmaking charm. I would wager that, if you wanted a movement to illustrate the wonder of simple, mechanical timekeeping, this would be the movement for the job. What's more, Vaer have decorated it more thoroughly than I would ever expect for this price, with extensive and aligned Geneva striping, blued screws, and a delightful Vaer signature. Perhaps what I like most about this Swiss movement is that it's the perfect successor to the kind of movement in the Dirty Dozen watches. Sure, it has 17 jewels to their 15, and is a trifle smaller, but it's exactly the modern equivalent. So, in the movement department, the A12 really is head and shoulders above the competition. But now one final consideration, legibility. This was always going to have to be a big part of the A12's appeal. You see, the black dial and luminous hands and markers were central to the original concept of these military watches in order to make life as easy as possible for the soldier wearing one, exactly what the modern A12 should also do. For the most part, Vaer have done a reasonably good job in this department. Aside from the excellent dial contrast which I've already spoken of, the sapphire crystal of this watch is subtly domed and with an anti-reflective coating on its inside. This does help to reduce glare, but perhaps due to the coating used, the blue tint given at certain angles can have the effect of muting the contrast between black and white elements. The luminous treatment of this watch is, as with some other parts, a mixed bag. In the first instance, the watch really goes out of its way to deliver a clean, crisp and modern design. C1 Superluminova has been selected over, for instance, C3, probably due to its cleaner colour, but at the expense of absolute brightness. Likewise, the Vaer logo is luminous to match the markers and Arabic numerals, but whilst the white paint on the dial is luminous, the second track and second hand are left entirely invisible. Surely these should glow in the dark instead of the logo. In any case, the legibility remains excellent, even if I wish that the treatment were somewhat more pragmatic. But how does the A12 compare as a whole package? For your money, you're getting a lot of watch. The movement is fantastic, the selection of straps and the steel bracelet are not only affordable, but very appealing, and create a wider array of options for this simple field watch. It's also extremely obvious that Vaer have taken serious measures to give you as much watch as possible, with an unheard of movement level for the price, two straps or bracelets out of the box, and to their credit, a very competitive list of specifications. By the same token, it is possible that this process, as well as the relative inexperience of such a young brand, mean that aspects such as finishing, which don't appear on the specs list, were somewhat overlooked. For a serious collector, these oversights might be too much to handle, but if one stops looking at this watch as a historical piece, and as more of a watch to appeal to the adventurous types interested, but not obsessive about watches, the A12 becomes an extremely exciting proposition. But what do you think of the Vaer A12? Is it a success for you, or does it miss the mark? Let me know in the comment section below. If you enjoyed this video, please remember to like, subscribe, and to hit the bell icon. It really helps. Thank you very much for watching. This is Armon from WatchChronicle.com. Out.